Why should you read the Bible? It's an important question to ask, whether you are a brand new Christian who's just starting in the faith, or you wandered away for quite some time and you're trying to restart your spiritual growth journey in Christ. We want you to start off on the right foot for the right reasons. Otherwise, sometimes our motivation will shape us in the wrong way, even though our actions are trying to shape us in the right direction. And we want your life, especially as it's rooted in Scripture, to be rooted in peace and joy, not something else. There is one overarching myth that seems to spill out into multiple other myths about why we should read Scripture, and it is summarized in one word: should. When we start to think we should read Scripture as opposed to something else that we'll talk about in a moment, it leads us into multiple mismotivations. And the number one myth that's related to that is this concept that you should read the Bible every day. It's easy to deal with that since the apostles didn't have the New Testament, Abraham didn't have a single page of Scripture, and all of them are celebrated for their life of faith. Nowhere in Scripture does it say you should read the Bible every single day. Not a single verse says that. And that's the first and most common myth. The second one follows after that, that I ought to read the Bible for a certain amount of time. You might have felt this way before, even if no one said it. I didn't read long enough. Well, there's no should or ought to in terms of how long you should read. Is it better to have time to reflect and think? Well, of course. But is it better to read some than none at all? Yes. There's no ought or should in how long you should read the Bible. The third myth is that I should change every time I read the Bible. Of course, we go to Scripture hoping for transformation into the likeness of Christ, but we can't expect that to happen in dramatic ways every time. So if you read Scripture and nothing changes, or you don't even get something out of it that particular day, remember that Scripture has a cumulative, forming effect on us over time, not an instant snap of the fingers. The fourth myth is that I should read the whole Bible in a year. A lot of people love this program, and if you haven't done it at some point in time in your Christian journey, you probably will. But it's not a should or an ought to. It's not a duty. It's not an obligation or a rule. If you get through the Bible this year, fine. If you don't, that's also okay. It's not a requirement for you to be a faithful Christian. The fifth myth is that I should read the Bible in order. A lot of new Christians start out with great motivation in Genesis, and they ram all the way through into Exodus, begin to slow down, and then they hit the brick wall of Leviticus and never read Scripture again. We don't want that for you. We want to guide you to great verses like Psalm chapter 1. I encourage you to read that, maybe even today, to root your faith in the right motivation for reading Scripture. What is the primary motivation according to Psalm chapter 1? The light. The person who is blessed by God delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on it day and night, Psalm 1 teaches us. So meditation in a form of delight is more important than rigid disciplines of specific structures of reading. The goal is to delight in God. What's the best description of the means of growth, how this all works? Well, Psalm 1 describes it as a tree planted by streams of living water, digging roots down into that soil that is funded by the stream with all kinds of living nutrients and the water it needs to grow. We want our roots as Christians to be in the living water of the Word, and we want to delight in it the way you would delight in a tall glass of cold water on a hot day. So work your motivation in that direction. Multiply the roots and tendrils of your life into Scripture, but allow it to become a peaceful productivity, sort of like a fruit-bearing tree planted by a stream. The fruit-bearing trees never seem to be working really hard. They just produce fruit naturally, as long as they stay rooted in the soil. Imagine it this way. Instead of a thunderstorm of rain, imagine a forest that is filled with mist. A misty wood, you might say. Imagine that wood was filled with mist, not just for one day or a week, but for an entire year, a misty year. If you dug down into the soil in that forest, an inch, a foot, 2 feet more, it would be soaked through over time. The branches, if you looked up, would start to drip with the water that had gathered on the tendrils of the branches and the out branches, all the way down to the smallest portions of the branches, would be dripping with water on a regular basis. We want you to have a misty year, in Scripture. So we want to talk to you about two contrasting ways of going at Scripture. One is the guilt machine, the other is the engine of desire. A guilt machine ramps up pressure like a steam-driven engine. It pressures you to read. It pressures you then to perform. Do Scripture reading well enough, change in your life well enough, and you almost evaluate yourself in the way you're reading Scripture. The guilt machine gives you pressure, it pressures you to perform, and the performance is trying to lead to a product. If you haven't produced enough in your life, you aren't good enough. The guilt machine is the wrong way to go about reading Scripture. Eventually, over time, it will shape you in legalism, not grace. We want you to be shaped in grace because that's how you came to Christ in the first place. That's how you'll continue to grow in Christ all the way through your life when you are rooted in the grace of Christ. Instead, start the engine of desire. It starts with a recognition that Christ promises to meet us while we're reading Scripture. He says, "You believe the Scriptures bring you salvation, read them. They testify to me." So search the Scriptures for Christ and His presence. Enjoy being with Him in a sense of peace. Christ says, "My peace I give to you, and I do not give as the world gives. I don't add trouble to it." So enjoy the presence of Christ while you're reading. Enjoy the peace of Christ while you're reading. And you heard me use the word enjoy twice. It can be a pleasureful thing. When that engine of desire gets started, it's sort of like a good lawnmower. Pull it once, and it just keeps going. You may have to pull it again later on if you stop reading, but one pull, and there you'll be in it again, enjoying the presence of Christ, the peace of Christ, and that pleasure will start to seep through your life. You will want to read Scripture more. So I often suggest people that they set up a way to read Scripture when they do that gives them pleasure, that surrounds them with pleasure, a cup of coffee or tea, a place that is a peaceful place, a space in which you can enjoy reading Scripture with God. And that's an important thing to remember. The real, true living Word, the living stream, is the presence of Christ through Scriptures. It's not Scripture itself that drives our engine of desire. It's love for Jesus Christ. So, as you're moving towards your increased reading of Scripture, we encourage you to work together with somebody who's walking relationally with you in your life of faith. Let them guide you to the right Scriptures to read first. Let them guide you to which Scriptures to memorize and to meditate on and to think about day and night. But you work at this. Delight in the law of the Lord. If you find yourself switching over to the guilt machine, switch back to the engine of desire. Remember the grace of God for you. Remember your sins that are forgiven. Remember that God is the fulfillment of all the greatest desires of your soul. Find ways to make it enjoyable. And I think that you will find your life slowly, imperceptibly, but over time, significantly transforming into the presence of Christ. May God bless you as you root yourself in the living Word.